machine. Maxella.
Yeah.
I miss you. I miss you, Maxie. I miss the girls of the world for that. Right, Jess? You miss your sister? Thank you. Jess, I miss you.
Thank you. you struggling with fishy discharge? Does your vagina feel a little off? Does it smell a little off no matter how many times you wipe? No matter what you do, no matter what you put in, no matter what you use to clean it out, it just, the smell does not go away. Well, I think you may have bacterial vaginosis. You know how I know? Because I've suffered with it for like most of my adult life, unfortunately. But I'm here with good news. If you are struggling, you don't have to struggle anymore, guys. Down below this video, I have a link to my step-by-step course where I show you exactly how I myself have... You all right? Where I show you step-by-step what I do to get rid of my bacterial vaginosis. Literally, like, the course is like 5 minutes, guys. I want to warn you, I made the video with this phone. So the quality may not be there, but that's besides the point. The video is very informative. It's a little kind of ghetto in my words, like it's not aesthetically pleasing, but it's straight to the point. I show you exactly what I do. It's taken me years to figure out the simple way of just clearing out your BV, and yeah, it works. It's effective. Once it's gone, it's gone. I have a video if you guys want to check it out, like just search in my videos, like bacterial vaginosis. I show you what to not do so it doesn't come back. But granted, if you don't do what you're not supposed to do, then it won't come back and you will be BV free. And that's how I've been. I really want to share this with you guys. The course is $10,997. I know it's a lot of money. Granted, it's really not. To some it may be, but yeah, in the video I get a little personal and it's taken me a long time to get this information, guys. So that's why it's a little bit, you know, on the high end. But it's definitely worth it if you're like stressed, if you have something to do, if you gotta like sleep with your man tonight, or you know, you just like have to get on with your life and you don't want to like leave the house smelling like a fish. Well, then buy my course and it'll literally be gone and you can like get ready and leave and you'll be good to go. So yeah, I hope you take advantage of this opportunity. I was thinking about making a Facebook group, but I'm not sure yet, but you can, I do have my number. Once you purchase the course, I do have my number. I think I need to update it because I changed my number. I do have my number. I need to take a mental note. I have my number. So if you want to text me, if you have any questions or you want to like quickly call me, we can schedule up something. If you have like, you know, you shouldn't have any issues. It's really straightforward, but yeah, I'm going to leave you with that. And I hope you guys, enjoy the rest of the video. Bye.
Bye.
I touch you?
I feel I probably panela.
Que si acá venden panela.
Lógico.
Sí, sí. No, no es lógico, sino que aquí todo lo que existe en el mundo, hay aquí. Lo que existe, porque si no existe, no lo veo.
A ver si me hago una panelita con limón. Voy a cuidarme hoy. Que ya ahora que esto se me quite. Vea eso, niño. Y ahora que me quite esta gripita.
Hola,
Thank you.
tengo algo. Espera que yo me invento.
Tú
mira a ver.
Thank you. Also promote it to their following and they're just
If you hire writers who are already popular and have a following, whatever they write, they're going to do the marketing for you. So even if you're paying 20 cents a word, it's actually a lot cheaper than hiring shitty writers, because these guys also do all the marketing, so you don't have to pay for the Facebook ads or any of that kind of
stuff. Exactly. And then for the telecast, one thing to make sure, I really get inspired by the KISS metrics, because I think this is really simple, right? There's like all these extra features in Trello I don't use, like you change colors.
Yep.
I see some people like comment they'll do that. I don't do that. I just create columns. Every person is responsible for a column.
That's right.
And once your job is to make sure whatever your column is, Maxi,
stop
yelling. And then you cannot mess that up, you know?
Yeah, and you can't. And it's really simple and scalable. Like I said, if you want to produce 1,000 pieces of content a week, we could really produce hundreds and hundreds, so it's not that much harder to scale. But cool, now you guys know how we produce content, and feel free to follow the process, jack our Trello boards, you know, do the same thing. You can go to job.trello.org and find writers that we're using probably on there for a lot of our customer stuff. It works.
You gonna eat?
Self that way. But now they need help and they need help with this content thing. So every person can just look at their calendar and say, where do I spend my time? And of those activities, what actually generates the most wealth or income and what lights me up? So to me, the best person to hire first is all the things that you don't like to do that you could say, you wouldn't allow a stranger to just walk into your office and demand something from you. But yet in today's world, that's how we do it. So it really depends on the individual's calendar of where they're spending their time. And it's really that filter of like, what's the least expensive thing you hate to do? Because when you take things that suck your energy out of your London company, that's actually what your customers want. So there's just a lot of beliefs around it. And when I look at most people's calendar, they're just spending a lot of time on $10 tasks. And what I've learned is you can't build a $1 million company running around in $10 tasks. It's just mathematically impossible. So you share the buyback rate calculation. What is the buyback principle first?
Yeah, the buyback principle states this, and this is a controversial thing. So you don't hire people to grow our business, you hire people to buy back our time. Because if you do the first, you don't get the second. If you do the second, you get the first. And so I call it a capacity over calendar problem. It's a lot of first-time entrepreneurs are just like, I'm busy, I need to hire people. I need to hire a person in the office. I need to hire a person in the warehouse. I need to hire a support person. I need to hire a programmer. I got to hire someone to create logos. But it's like, no. You can do those activities because those are like hiring a designer to do logos for you. You don't have to pay him $35-$50 an hour. But what you're going to still do $8, $10. You're going to run. So one of my friends in construction, and I remember he was overwhelmed. And I was just like, tell me about your overwhelm. And in his explanation of his week, I identified that he spent 2 days a week running around site to site to site. And I'm like, dude, that's called a runner. That's a person you can hire. Part-time, a kid, because all you're doing is literally taking equipment from one place to another place. And while they're doing that, you could be on calls with potential customers, hiring better team members, training your team. But these are not things that you do, but it's just, I think sometimes we just get addicted to the activity. It's like email. It's like, is that really the best use of your time? No, but at least I know that when I wake up, if I just like follow it, I'll feel productive. But it's a false sense of productivity because it actually doesn't move your goal groups forward. So the buyback principle is we start by hiring people to buy back time out of our calendar. And by doing that, then we fill it with stuff that makes us more money, that lights us up, and that will support us having more resources to actually build a business.
So then you have what's called a buyback rate calculation. So people would be thinking, well, I can't afford to have somebody help me. For a lot of content creators, they should hire a video editor. Is maybe one of those first things. That was what did it for me. I was spending, when I had video, it took me 4 to 8 hours to edit. When I stopped doing that, I recovered a ton of time. And if it was multiple videos, I could recover 30 to 40 hours a week by no longer editing video. But what is the buyback rate calculation to maybe determine if you should hire what you can afford?
So last night, yeah. So is it a video editor? Maybe, unless they're spending a lot of time in other areas and there's 10 hours they can buy back at a lower cost outtasking. Right? So it's kind of like you stack. So is it a video editor? Maybe. But it may be somebody else first, then the video editor or somebody else. And that's what I was explaining to this person last night. Because like when I asked him how much he was making in his YouTube channel, like, and he was like, well, how much do I have to pay a good editor? And I'm like, there's no amount of money that it wouldn't make sense when you're telling me you spend 30 hours a week editing. Like, you're making a lot of money. And when you look at it, it has nothing to do with that trade. So if the formula is 2,000, you divide that, that's your value per hour. Then you divide it by 4, because I want you to get a 4x ROI on the buyback.
Yeah.
So if you hire somebody to clean your house and you pay them, you know, $500 a week because they come a couple times, then you've bought back 8 hours. Now what do you do with those new 8 hours to go invest in your business or invest in your health or invest in your relationships? It doesn't have to be always a monetary thing. Because the last chapter of the book is actually about that lifestyle. But I know for a lot of people, like, we need to keep it in dollars and cents initially.
Yeah.
And that's how it works. So if it's 100 grand and you divide it by 2,000, then you divide it by 4, it works at about $12.50. Some people would be like, well, I can't pay anybody to make me for 12 bucks. First off, your house versus you driving to go pick it up. These are like little mental things that people don't consider when they actually analyze their calendar or their energy audit, that they could be buying back their time. But if you're making, a lot of the clients I coach, I mean, they're making $500,000 a year plus.
Yeah.
Their buyback rate is $62.50.
Yes.
There's a lot of stuff they're doing in their calendar they should just not be doing anymore.
But even if you're maybe working, let's say, a day job, you got some money coming in on your side hustle, a lot of people listen to this, they're trying to transition to being a 75,000 divided by 2,000. And so then that would mean, how much you make per hour? No, divided by 4 to get the 4 times I want. Yeah, so then you make $37.50 per hour if you net 75,000.
So when you work right now, you're making $37.50.
That's how much you keep, that's money then. And of course, you gotta deploy that. And if you're in the startup phase, you have to deploy that on rent or your mortgage or your car payment or whatever. But leave it be, because you should be reinvesting in your business. So then you divide that by 4, and that's $9.
Yeah.
You're at around $10 an hour. You do have online jobs at PH.
You can have a full-time dedicated virtual assistant 40 hours a week for like $700 a month.
That's wild. And there's services we recommend, things like VidChops or VidChops, which allow you to drop off your footage and I think they'll edit 4 videos for you a month for a couple hundred bucks. So this is becoming incredibly practical. So
I'll like draw stuff and I'll record that to the cloud and then just share my iCloud link. Or I'll jump on Zoom, share my screen, and it's just me. And I'm recording it on Zoom because it's just so easy, and then my assistant can pick it up and put it in the folder. And so essentially, what I do is I record everything, knowing that I'm going to eventually buy back that time. And then when I hire the person, their first week, and it's not glamorous, is watching 40 hours worth of content.
Yeah.
But then they create the SOP. They create the playbook, SOP, standard operating procedure. And what's cool about that is they get to watch me do the work, so it's training. They get to try to play this game of like, what is the pattern that I should be seeing in the work? And then they document what they saw. And through that, then I get a feedback loop at the end of the week when I hire them. So Monday you start, here's a document that's got links to all the recording, the Dropbox, go through that, create the SOP. On Friday, I get to see how well they understood it. So like last night I was talking to this guy and he was like, no, you can edit it. I understand you believe that. I would actually run an experiment with you or I'll pay for the editor. And all I'm gonna do is have him go watch your top 5 videos. And I know a good editor is not an idiot. They're gonna look at the videos and they're gonna go, I see how he does his pinch. I don't even know his terminology, but you know what I mean? They're gonna see it and I'm gonna have them write out an SOP for how you open, how you transition, the music things, the volume levels, and they're just gonna write it out. And I bet they would do something that if you showed a friend and said, which of these two edits do you think is the better one? They might pick the other person.
Yeah.
That moment, I remember like when you have somebody else produce work and you weren't involved, and I say this in the book, 80% done by somebody else is 100% freaking awesome.
Yeah.
Right? But the moment you have somebody actually do work that's better than you would have done, why? Because that's the only thing they're doing because they can take their time to do it really well, it's an unlock for people. It takes that ceiling of complexity and just blows it wide open.
So this is an ego, this is offensive to our egos. Because one of the other excuses is no one can do as good at the work as I can. And as a video editor, I struggled with this. I actually thought that as soon as I started working with another editor, his name was Jay at the time, when we finally got one of his videos ready to release, I thought that was gonna be the day that my YouTube comments flooded with people saying, you betray us, how dare you not edit your own videos, you sold out, we are unsubscribing. And then, can you guess how many comments I got when the video edited by somebody else came out on Think Media?
As many as you had before, and nobody said anything.
And nobody said anything.
Nobody.
Zero comments. I just remember, I've been editing videos since 2003, so I, you know, it's one of my biggest skill sets. The truth is, two things, right? No one is as good at the work as I am. That's either a myth, or if they can at least do it 80%, that's 100% freaking awesome.
Yeah.
Because 80% is going to be sufficient. In creativity and in content, it's also kind of subjective.
Yeah.
What do you mean? What is a good edit? Well, is it going to entertain people? Do people like it and enjoy it? A lot of creativity can be really subjective.
Well, and there's a framework I teach in the book, because I did write it for that. When I wrote down the 25 people in my life that I love, that I knew were struggling with coming back their time, I pretty much like used them as like, okay, what's their rejection? This, what's this? Okay, and one of them was this concept. Like, I'm a creative. What I do is very nuanced. Nobody can do it as good as me. First 10% of the project with the team to really talk about what are we trying to do? What is the story arc? What is the narrative structure? What is the resources we have access to? What do we think it should look like? And it's Steve Jobs leaving his office and going to Johnny Ives in the design studio and just saying to Johnny, like, I think we can get our hard drive that's long to do the back of our pockets. I don't think it does exist. It's like, go see. Right? Or, hey, what if we did a translucent background on these? So like lollipop colors. And he's like,
plastic. Go see. Right, it's that first 10%. And then, you know, Johnny would take these crazy requests or ideas and then work with his team to prototype and pull out the CNC machine and use foam models and all this stuff. And then they would eventually get to a place where they had these finished products, but Steve would still come in at the end of that last 10% and polish it, right? So that none of them ever left the factory floor without his stamp on it. So that's what I'm saying. I'm not saying you delegate and advocate and just be like, I hope it works out.
Yeah.
It's just take that 80% of the heavy lifting, give it to somebody else, and then at the end, you can come in and look at the edit and go like, oh, let's do this here, let's do this jump cut, boom, 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 boom. And then the final product still has your essence and soul. And I think that framework has helped a lot of creators go like, oh, I can see how now I have these different like workflows where I can still be creative using the 1080-10 rule and not feel like I'm going to lose that.
That's super powerful. So the first 10%, you kind of make Jess's idea the direction. You're giving some concrete and 80% of the time somebody else is doing the middle 80%, and then the final 10% you're tweaking it, but you just bought back 80% of the time.
Yes.
And so you have massive leverage created there. We're really on something I think is very creative because there's a unique resistance to this when it comes to creativity. And I think for some, like the creator you're speaking to last night, and I'm listening to, who they just hold it so hard. Who produced something like 85,000 pieces of unique art in his career. And that story really inspired me because it actually made me think about, you know, what is my art? And when I think about these videos, I think I've uploaded over 2,000 videos now. We're not doing vertical video, we're doing around 328 pieces of content a week. This is all insane. There's no way this is happening if there wasn't 18 people working in Think Media and 10 contractors and systems. But clearly, it is not my hand on 80%, or even if I get less than that, of the work.
Oh!
Thank you.
dark green.
This is a light green. Orange.
More green.
Why? Go with the little money.
I'm so overwhelmed. Table mat, please. No, Maxi, these are mine. Those are yours. You gotta share. Okay, these are mine. Those are yours. You eat those. Yes, baby. Truck is here. Uh-oh, come here, Max. She's gonna ring the doorbell. That she's gonna come.
We will be back.
shoot kids. I have so many kids. Everybody wants to have their kids for that. And I'm scared of that. Because I can't have everybody's baby. Because it's the scary thing for a mommy. A lot of kids for that.
beleza? Dobro mi to ravno, ali pre to doći? Si? Quando ladrò, farò la voce. Tirate il volume alla parte maggiore. A ver si mi bebé, lo que tengo para mi bebé aquí, a ver, lo que tengo para mi bebé. Todo yo creo puesto así, de mal humor. ¡Oh, lo otro ahora! ¿Tú también quieres un helado? Papa, frijoles. Ah, ¿verdad, mi amor? ¿Te gustó? ¿Te gustó, verdad? ¿Te gustó?
Sí, sí.
¿Hablaste de ti? ¿Qué hablaste, madre?
Chocho, ¿y esto dónde te arrancaste de atrás?
Ay, ¿qué pasó, pichicho? ¿Qué pasó, pichicho?
¿De Publix?
No. La cerró por ahí porque no fue a pobre, no es lo que me mandó.
¿Qué pasó, papi? ¿Qué pasó?
Voy a poner las enlace. Ay, Dios. ¿Qué pasó?
Are you struggling with fishy discharge? Does your vagina feel a little off? Does it smell a little off no matter how many times you wipe? No matter what you do, no matter what you put in, no matter what you use to clean it out, it just, the smell does not go away. Well, I think you may have bacterial vaginosis. You know how I know? Because I've suffered with it for like most of my adult life. Unfortunately. But I'm here with good news. If you are struggling, you don't have to struggle anymore, guys. Down below this video, I have a link to my step-by-step course where I show you exactly how I myself have, you right? Where I show you step-by-step what I do to get rid of my bacterial vaginosis. Literally, like, the course is like 5 minutes, guys. It works, it's effective. Once it's gone, it's gone. I have a video if you guys want to check it out, like, just search in my videos, like, bacterial vaginosis. I show you what to not do so it doesn't come back. But granted, if you don't do what you're not supposed to do, then it won't come back and you will be BV free. And that's how I've been. The course is $10,997, but it's definitely worth it. If you're like stressed, if you have something to do, if you gotta like sleep with your man tonight, or you know, you just like have to get on with your life and you don't wanna like leave the house smelling like a fish, well then buy my course and it'll literally be gone and you can like get ready and leave and you'll be good to go. So yeah, I hope you take advantage of this opportunity. Bye. Bye.
in my chair?
Also, when we move on, we will also find the second part of the code, which is this one here, which we should also implement. So now that the Google Tag Manager move on, we will also find the second part of the code, which is this site. So just to show you this, we open the test shop, and when I do a right click on new page source, I can see the code on my website, and I search for Google Tag Manager, and as you can see, the plugin already implemented some code. When we go on searching, we will find the first part of the code which Google Tag Manager told us to implement, and also when we move on, we will also find the second part of the code, which is this one here, which we should also implement. So now that the Google Tag Manager is implemented on our site, we of course need to configure Google Tag Manager to send event data to Google Analytics, and therefore we click on OK here, and now we click on tags in this left section.
En Metro, obtén un nuevo iPhone 12 con 5G. Toma fotos increíbles y comparte al instante. Tú no haces.
Here we click on New, and we first define a name. So it will be a Google Analytics 4 tag, and it will be implemented to track page views, and we will basically track it on all pages. So this will be the configuration tag for Google Analytics 4. You only have to do the Google Analytics 4 configuration implementation once. So on tag, click on tag configuration, then select Google Analytics GA4 configuration, and here we now need to implement the measurement ID. So we go back to Google Analytics, and you can see this is the 4 configuration, and here we now need to implement the measurement ID. So on tag, click on tag configuration, then select Google Analytics GA4 configuration, and here we now need to implement the measurement ID. So we go back to Google Analytics, and you can see this is the measurement. ID. So we copy it nested in here, but we will create a constant. So a variable of type constant, which will be then inserted here. So we click on this building block. Then we click on the plus of type constant, which will be then inserted here. So we click on this building block. Then we click on the plus sign. And here we will define the name of our constant. So it is a constant and it is the Google Analytics measurement ID. Then we configure the variable. We choose that it is a constant. We implement the value here. And we click on save. Then we configure the variable. We choose. That it is a constant. We implement the value here. And we click on save. And now you can see that the code for the constant is implemented here. Again, we could also simply write down our measurement ID directly in here. Then we set the trigger and we basically want to fire on all pages so that all pages will be tracked and that the Google Analytics 4 configuration is set on all pages. Then we click on save. And now we can do some checks. So first of all, we can click on preview. And here we first...
packages. Wouldn't it be great if you can here? So for account name, I'm going to be doing this for my website, Wicker Guide Plus 2, if that's possible. And this one after the open installed on our website. Actually, what you're doing is you're making your Google. So all we need to do here is just so we're all set up. The last thing we need to do here is click on container, not publish. So we just have to click on submit. We need to publish our container. So all we need to do here is just do publish container. So we just have to click on submit. We need to publish our container. So all we need to do here is just do publish container. And we'll do the same thing here, publish container. So I sent, and we'll do this container. So we're all set up. The last thing we need to do here is click on container, not publish. So we just have to click on submit. We need to publish our container.
Thank you.
here, publish container. So essentially what you're doing is you're making your Google Tag Manager live right now. So you can see publish to environment, live, just click on publish. So that's what you need to do. To complete the process of installing Google Tag Manager on WordPress. Now what we'll do at the very end is you can use the Tag Assistant plugin, which is available through Google Chrome. So you can see Tag Assistant, it's offered by Google. Just install it to Chrome. You can see I have it up right at the top here. So you can make sure that you have your Google Analytics and Google Tag Manager properly installed on your website. So the next thing that we want to do is we want to come over and we want to create and install our Google Analytics account. So get to know your customers. If you're not familiar with why you want to use Google Analytics, essentially what it's going to do is show you where.
Viral fetish?
Ah.
Vamos a ver si va a venir el rumbo.
Put in dirty clothes. In the dirty clothes.